We might just have to imagine the church in the future, everyone.
Java yeah, don't link a legal argument exception comparison method violates contract.
Violates a contract, yes. Okay. Then our next step is, Joseph, you arrive at the church, not a big deal. How long does Joseph wish to, stand here by this shack? We'll say it's 12:34 in the morning right now.
He can cross town in an hour and a half, so he'll be picked up an hour and a half before sunrise. Sunrise. And he has a cell phone now, so he can call if he needs Craig earlier.
All right, we'll focus on the other individual characters then during that time period. I know what David's going to be doing. We'll handle that one last. Marcus is going to go out and hunt. And might as well have some. Well, you're going to automatically succeed if you go all the way to Astoria. So let's go and have a self-control roll, Marcus. Difficulty 6. Please. Pretty please.
Are you asking me?
Was asking Jordan.
That's what I thought, but you kept asking.
I
I was like,
th I think it's
sure.
yours.
That bastard. All right, fine. What's Byron gonna be doing after he stormed out? Heading back to Astoria? Gonna drown
Yeah.
himself with some newspapers and stuff?
I'm going to head back to my haven for now. Oh, I gotta change my blood points. I guess yeah, down to 10. But yeah, I'm gonna try calling up what was where's the Tremere? It's at that woman's college. I'll see if I can get like a I don't know what kind of capacity she works there, if any. But I'll try to see if I can get in touch with her that way.
Nah. I'll go ahead and tell you right now, Byron can certainly spend his time doing that, but it's just going to be a dead end.
All right, well, let's say he spends a couple hours doing that. He'll try to
Okay.
find some food after that. I'll just hunt in Astoria.
Yeah, he was down to 10, but he's fully healed. Yeah. All right. You still gone, Jordan?
No, I'm back, sorry.
That's
Internet
fine.
got done.
Go ahead and make a self-control roll in difficulty 6 for me since you're poking around for bloodsies. Since you're hungry right now. Okay, you're fine. Go ahead and spend a few hours getting yourself drunk, alone, off of people.
Yep. That's the plan.
All right, David.
Aaron, are you there?
How does David Green want to go about doing this?
Well, he's going to go back to his sanctum and post on the ShrekNet that he's looking for a way to reliably get in contact with the Tremere. Specifically with the High Regent, if possible. Willing to trade information and such in exchange.
Well, let's see. Go ahead and have, say you're trying to be all persuasive about this and shit. We'll go ahead and have some sort of persuasive role here. Where you might be doing like manipulation plus empathy or maybe charisma plus that or something, since you're trying to, convey and you're looking around, you're hoping for people to answer, pitch in an offer, basically. See how well you can write your BBS post.
Could not execute the command. Huh.
God damn it. Everything is broken. It's all ruined. Maybe it's all your fault. All four of you.
There we go.
See, Cripson's rolls are disappearing. Now David's rolls are disappearing.
Oh, no, they weren't even rolling.
Okay. Let's see. That'll actually work. Within a few hours, I'll actually focus you in on this area. Now, you'll see this area that's north of Eugenio Estevez's domain and south of Kadir's territory. Once upon a time, that used to just say the Tremere domain. Now it says the Maupassant room. This actually serves as the Tremere's, basically, internal center of communications. This is primarily where they meet with kindred from other clans. This is pretty much your best hope of getting in touch with the Tremere. It's really the only acceptable place that kindred from other clans can actually meet with them. The regent from this, of this chantry, as it turns out, it's the one most publicly known from the Tremere to the other clans. It's the one most likely known, is actually Genie himself, Eugenio Estevez. It's quite small. It's basically, it's just the Maupassant room there. You have like an office space there, basically. That's where this room itself has been taken out. They have an office building there.
And do you just show up, or do you get an appointment, or
for folks who if you're looking to have business and consorting with the Tremere, not everyone can make an appointment, but it's the most socially acceptable place where you're not going to offend the Tremere by just showing up. You'll end up probably talking with a Tremere neonate or something, and if whatever you have to say might be interesting enough, you might, say, have a meeting with a Genie himself.
And is it a place that a Nosferatu can show their face? Or,
well, it's in Manhattan. It's an office building that the Tremere entirely controls, and they use for whatever it is the Tremere do. Once you're inside the building, it'll be fine. It's just, of course, and no Nosferatu is going to have a problem being outside of it. But of course, you know, there's the warnings about basically everything, whether it's rumored or truth, anything that basically the Tremere can do. Warlocks are. You know, this goes over the situation, like, the Nosferatu can do a pretty good job of hiding and being sneaky from all mortals, almost all of them, and to an extent, almost all kindred. Tremere, kind of in that category where you don't want to upset them.
Right.
So there's definitely warning messages as well.
All right, well, then, if there's no specific way to get an appointment in advance, I guess tomorrow I'll head on down.
As a matter of fact, it seems to be the case that apparently only two Tremere actually live there. There's the regent and his assistant. So you would pretty much be dealing straight with them, which means you'd be dealing straight with Genie.
All right, and that office doesn't have like a listed public phone number or anything?
No. It's off the grid.
Okay. Then yeah, I'll probably head over there tomorrow just to, see if the sheriff brought by the artifact and if they have any questions.
Okay. Are you going to convey this information to the others like David had mentioned he would?
Yep. He's going to call up Marcus first and tell him. And then, after some quiet consideration, he'll decide to call up Byron after all.
Okay, and that'll be done. All right, focusing on Joseph, you're about looking at 4:30-ish. It's about an hour before sunrise where you're really just going to go ahead and make a perception plus alertness at difficulty 6. Please, Joseph. Plox, Galor, THX, Pi. If you would be so kind. Yeah, you didn't see anything. You've just been standing out here and in front of, you know, obfuscated, in front of this the shed entrance into the lair of Sevalod Cervene. Nuh-uh. No one's come past.
That door hasn't opened up.
Door has not opened a single centimeter. You've been listening. There's been no noises on the other side. There's, like, the noises of the park, but it's pretty eerily quiet, Central Park is, especially ensconced in this dark area.
Okay, now I'm considering. I've got to go back. I'm considering whether or not to leave Craig here for... I guess he should be... I hope he'll be safe if he just stays here for an hour or an hour and a half until sunrise.
Alright, so you're just going to travel back through Metro? Or taxi?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll just... Once he gets here to pick me up, I'll tell him to stay near the door. Some ways away, and just watch the door, and if that door opens and he somehow misses it, I'll strangle him with his own intestine. And
it's not something that he can watch from the car either. It's something that he
yeah,
actually has to
he'll
get out.
He'll have to be in the park. He'll have to be in the park, which is why I was considering it back and forth. Do I want to risk being without any ghouls at all, or any ghouls at all? But yeah, I'll risk his face. He'll sit there in the park, and he'll watch that door. And once sunrise up, I guess he'll eventually have to come back. I can't watch it literally 24/7.
Are you going to take a Dragon Metro cab back?
I'll call a different Metro cab company. If not, I'll take the subway.
Okay.
Or something. I'll figure something else out.
Joseph manages. It's cutting it close there. I don't know. There's a hiccup in the subway at one point. You know, it's a bit of maintenance work. You know, some problem apparently. You know, talk about like people spotted here. You know, like mountains of rat corpses everywhere. Some sort of crazy bullshit people talk about.
Hey, I mean, worst case scenario, he can always, you know, sprint back since vampires don't get tired.
That's right. But, Joseph makes it back into his haven. Does he call any of the others before sunrise hits to spread the word about not spotting the sheriff?
Yeah, if he has time to, he'll call up, David first.
Okay. That information is spread out then.
And, all right, one other thing, there is one other thing he wants to say to David while he has him on the phone.
Okay.
Well, David's also going to tell him that he's going to be stopping by the Tremere, what was it, the Moussant room or something?
Yeah, the Moussant room. It's a chantry, which apparently is a social chantry where kindred from other clans can actually go and meet with Tremere. The only two permanent residents are Genie and his assistant, but other Tremere have been known from what... David gleamed to use the establishment as well. It's basically so that no other clans are basically seen in the other chantries. Although a powerful figure, there might be an exception made for that.
Alright, well, he's going to inform him that he is planning on going over there first thing tomorrow night.
Yeah, that all said, I think informing the sheriff of what happened, all the details may have been a bad choice. We still don't know where exactly he lies on the scope of things.
I still don't know where all of you lie on the scope of things, but yes, you're right, it may have been a bad decision on my part. I probably wouldn't have if Byron hadn't said to go ahead and tell him everything. I guess he didn't quite mean everything. Everything.
Perhaps I'm being a little harsher on you than I should be, but
oh,
as
no,
an
I quite
Nosferatu,
understand.
you should, as an
I should have shown
Nosferatu,
a bit
you
of
should know.
discretion.
Yeah, as a Nosferatu, you should be one of the most knowing that knowledge is power.
No, I absolutely agree. Was there anything else?
No, that was it.
All right. Stay safe and sleep well.
I'll try to.
And then he hangs up the phone. And would David have had time after finding out this information on the Mopassant room to go hunting?
He could have done it while waiting for the information to get posted.
About how many hours would he have had to do that?
We'll say four.
All right, well then I would actually be using all of that time, if possible, for hunting.
Sure.
And, David is actually hoping that he'll have, just kind of out of character, but he's hoping that he'll have enough time after the visit to the Tremere to stop by and continue some of his training and therapy and stuff.
Right. Of course, you don't know how long the visit with the Tremere will end up taking you the next
right,
day.
Right, he's just kind of hoping.
Right.
So that's, like, wits plus subterfuge.
Yeah, we'll say that, and we'll be difficulty three for all 4 hours. Oh.
Yeah, one of them failed. Didn't botch. Failed, though.
Two of them failed.
Oh, yep, two of them failed. But no botches, at least.
In that case, David's only going to get 4 points of blood in his blood, assuming he took two from the first two.
He did. He's not terribly hungry, but he could definitely use a top off.
There you go. In that case, 4 points of blood. And that will take care of the sort of evening type thing. Although Byron, of course, probably had a few hours there at the end. Byron also, you did say he was going to go hunting. Go and have your like your social type seduction type thing. It'll be a difficulty three.
He's in no mood for that. He's just going to go dominate people, and he's going to suggest women go to the bathroom and follow him in there at bars.
All right, dominate's perfectly fine. There's not going to be a problem with that. All right.
Mind rape.
Oh, yeah. He's just pissed. He's just like, I'm not going to finesse it. Just bathroom now.
I love that image. It's great.
That's an interesting image.
So.
All right.
Let's see. Do I need to roll some for it?
Yeah, we'll be fine. I'd just only be fishing for botches there, because these characters certainly aren't going to have a whole lot of willpower. I don't feel like doing it. Remember, don't make things more complicated. Alright, so, Wednesday, March 18th, 1998, it's another bright, beaming, sunshiny day. You know, folks who might have been wanting to do, like, training stuff if they had, out of coterie business to attend to, might have been playing hooky a little bit. Probably not a big deal.
How much blood did I get from last night?
We could say you only had to make one self-control roll. You could be back up to full. And fucking drunk as fuck. Drunking fruck.
Just the way I like it.
He's drunk as drunk.
Mr. Fame Man. Your legend only seems to grow, Marcus.
His legend groweth.
Just like his dick. No, so, day continues. It becomes night. Night falls on Wednesday, March 18th. And eventually it rolls a bit past 10-ish in the eve, and the four of you awaken, subtracting a point from your blood pools.
I'm going to subtract 5 more to heal that last point of aggro.
Okay. Joseph, we'll start with you. Craig didn't spot anyone.
Well, then I hope the Tremere tell us that they have it. That said, he's going to call up one of his herd.
Okay. Just have you do the willpower roll, difficulty 6 right now, Joseph. Alright, looks like you got it. It would be unfortunate if you weren't useful at this critical accident moment in time. Byron, Marcus, hang out, play Nintendo, wait for a call.
Yeah, Byron is going to, he's going to call up O'Malley and see if she needs anything or wants anything. He wants to take his mind off everything. That last night just pissed him off. So,
right. Yeah, she's doing all right. Business is doing well.
All right. He's going to be disappointed that there's nothing to take his mind off the events. He's going to, I don't know how she'll react to that, but he's going to say, "You don't need me? Really? Dang it." All right.
She would say that. "I never said I didn't need you. Only the, you know. There's no work for you to do here."
Yes, yes. All right, keep up the good work. And then Byron will go and, I don't know, find a paper and read it or something. Try anything to get his mind off of what's been going on.
Okay. Of course, Marcus just, you know, takes a shower, stares at a skin, which thankfully no longer has those bite problems.
Yay.
Know, perhaps sort of compulsively, might check the blood points at his vitae. Okay, they're all there. That's good. His blood level is exactly how he remembers it, how he left it.
I mean, if it becomes an actual real problem, I'll actually have him mark down, like, on a piece of paper how many blood points he should have, any theoretical things he should have.
Yes. And of course, David wakes up, goes through his ritual of taking a shower.
Yeah, because basic personal hygiene and caring about your appearance, that's a ritual now.
Yep. For David Green, it is. So how are we traveling to the Mabasad room? How are we bundling together in a little pretty package?
I'm gonna wear a decent suit.
With a top hat?
No!
Then what good are you for?
And then take the subway there.
You're going alone?
Yeah, I mean, no one else really expressed an interest in going along, I thought. I did call up everyone to tell them last night. Did any of them express any interest in going along?
Joseph would have.
Joseph wants to go.
I thought that he didn't express any particular interest one way or the other.
Well, David's horrible at reading social cues over the telephone.
Apparently. Well, I mean, he said he was planning on going there first thing in the evening, so it's perfectly possible we might all meet there.
Did you give him the address?
Nope.
Well then, David Green.
So, you know, let's see if he gets any phone calls.
Good job, Coterie, mate. Good job.
Hey.
Joseph will.
No one said they wanted to go along with him, so...
We skipped over the phone calls. It's one of those assumed things. Like, I don't assume, you know, I don't make you state explicitly every single time you carry around things.
I actually am asking, would anyone have expressed interest?
Joseph just said he would.
Yeah, Byron would have gone. He would have been annoyed still at the whole situation, but he wants to get on top of this. So.
All right, in that case, he's probably going to be meeting people at O'Malley Real Estate.
Yeah, Astoria Estates.
Right, Astoria Estates. Well, actually, we have two different sites, don't we? We have O'Malley Real Estate, which is a burned-out wreck of a building, and Astoria Estates, which is a functional office building.
Yes. And, then there's the Majestic. I don't know whether you guys actually wanted to buy that, or you actually bought it, or you've been looking to any of that stuff, but, you know, it's abandoned. It's a thing.
I think we actually did buy it, didn't we?
I think it's bought, or at least being leased by us. I mean, we own it, you know, in quotes.
Yeah, I thought we were, we tapped our cash reserves for the month to at least put down the payment, the first payments on it.
I just wanted to make sure. I thought so, but I didn't get any explicit confirmation, like David didn't get any explicit confirmation that anyone wanted to go with him. Because he's sad.
Right, and I will note something, Aaron, that when David mentioned, told Byron not to stick his foot in his mouth, that really struck a nerve with him. You would have noticed that's when he went from zero to pissed and just left.
Yep.
Listen, man who keeps falling in torpor, you useless son of a bitch.
Basically, yeah. I just bailed your ass out of the fire. I went and stole blood for you. I killed that fucking thing when I should have run. And you know, he's pissed. He's like, don't you judge me.
You know what, Marcus? You're my best friend now. The other two, annoying.
Woo! Moving on up the world.
Can I use your shower? Yes, anytime.
Can I use your shower again?
Go ahead. Feel free. Knock yourself out.
Woo!
On second thought, I probably shouldn't say that. You may take it literally. Don't knock yourself out. But go ahead and use the shower anyway.
Fuck you, I'll do what I want!
I don't think Mark wants to go talk to the Tremere. Well, you know what?
Does Marcus he want to be alone again?
No, Marcus doesn't want to be alone again. Remember what happened last time? He doesn't remember last time. He literally doesn't remember last time. Because it turns out his memories are false. Take me with you, David. Green.
So you do want to go?
Yes.
All right, well, everyone's meeting at Astoria Estates.
Oh, cool. That's just down the street.
And try to wear something nice.
Nice?
Yeah, like something with a jacket and buttons.
I have a denim jacket.
You don't even own a tie, do you?
What's a tie?
Now he's just being a smartass.
I might have a tie, or maybe I have a tie from, maybe I have a tie in that jacket from that one time Byron let me in his suit.
You gotta have like a bolo tie or something, right? Those are all the rage in the 90s for, you know, subtle punk rockers.
No, they're not.
I was...
They're all the rage for shitty... college-aged yuppies.
I know, but that's the whole point. I was saying for something... Nah, never mind. Go moving on.
I probably have. Just let me scrounge around my closet of clothes I haven't messed with for, like, years. Needless to say, Marcus will attempt to be at O'Malley Astoria Estates dressed sort of decently.
Yeah, all you really need is a polo shirt, denim shorts, and some sort of sports coat or something. Or not, I mean, denim pants. And that, then you look passable.
Well, like, you don't even need to wear a tie, just as long as the thing has buttons.
Right.
I probably got something like that, maybe. I don't know. Let me check. Yeah, I got a shirt from... Does this shirt even fit me?
So everyone meets at Astoria Estates.
And Byron decides to mount Joseph.
Yeah, well, it's the whole betting thing coming around. He's still really into that, apparently.
All right. It's 11:10 by the time you all organize together here. And by the time you arrive at the Ma Passant room, you're probably looking at 11:35. To find a parking spot and get near there, and, you know, it does look like a nice enough building of sorts. This office building here that David was told about, and sure enough, I mean, it's not like it's derelict, it's just doesn't look like it's being used for anything. You know, like, maybe it's, like, perpetually for sale. You know, prime office space here in Manhattan, it's being disguised as one thing or another. This, section of the city here. Madison Avenue and 77th Street. Not that far from Sheriff Kadir's territory. Of course, there's that feeling which may or may not pop in all of your heads. You may or may not care. The buyer might not care, I don't know. You know, that sort of concept where you're walking into the chantry of the warlocks. Where they do all sorts of crazy blood magic shit. You've all heard rumors and stories about what they can do. Probably things that they aren't able to do, but you can never count them out.
Yeah, the only thing Byron knows about them is that his sire hated them. I mean, just thought that they were diabolists and stole their power and whatever. She scoffed at them a lot.
Actually do end up walking into the interior of the building. It's not locked by the looks of things. Well-lit area here on this ground floor. It goes up about two dozen stories or so. Look around. It's not opiate, you know, it's not opiate, that's for sure. It's not opulent.
Opiates.
It's
heroin, you say.
It's not opulent, you know, it's not, you know, fine wealth and ornately decorated. It's, you know, middle class, you know, just like it's a fucking practical sort of design. There's a desk there, which would sort of be something like the front desk of where, like, a security guard might normally sit for, like, an actual office building or what have you. There's no metal detectors around. Not a whole lot much of anything suspicious or horrific in nature that you're all about to suddenly die. Just sort of empty there, just standing there, hanging out playing Nintendo. There's a bell on the desk. One of those things that you tap and it rings.
Tap it.
Now you've given them your soul, Malkavian. I hope you're happy.
Ding, ding! Coming!
I keep waiting.
Marcus is going to tap hands on the desk, rudimentary, you know, beat and rhythm.
So, Byron is going to look to Joseph and say, "So, what happened to you last night?"
Nothing.
I love how he said that so despondently. Nothing.
I wish I had caught the sheriff giving the artifact to Sevalod Cerveni.
So he's PO'd at Byron and David both.
Eventually, someone does respond to the bell. Perhaps the owner of the voice who responded whenever it was rung. Well-dressed woman, you know, dressed in a whole business suit as if she appears to be in some sort of, you know, office working thing, perhaps in a secretarial format. She's wearing glasses that sort of hang off from a chain. She looks fairly young. Late 20s, early 30s, hale and hearty. She doesn't look like she's a vampire. But certainly you've been deceived by appearances before over the course of your lives. And it's not like you ever felt that vampires existed once upon a time anyway. fairly attractive, not overly so. She's not exactly dressed to show herself off anyway. You know, business related and practical. Sort of looks through the spectacles at the four of you like, oh, was there an appointment you four had? Can I help you with something?
We were actually hoping to check in and see if you could use any help regarding an artifact that the sheriff brought the Chantry last night.
An artifact? The sheriff? She looks a little confused, and she actually ends up walking to the desk where there's a telephone on it. Punches a number, and then a few numbers, and then more no. She starts punching numbers, presses another button instead. Sort of quirks her head, says, "Jeannie, are you available? There's these four gentlemen here about some sort of artifact and the sheriff bringing it, and... Yeah? You sure? Okay. Jeannie says, come right on up. She hangs up the phone. 14th floor on the right.
Thank you very much.
Byron is going to say, how many windows are up there? He's going to glance at Joseph.
Not that many. They're all well covered, those few that are. Don't exactly want the sunlight pouring in. She sort of
Perfect.
Smiles.
Of course. Thank you. And Byron is going to make his way to the elevator.
A building decorated with something sensible. Especially for being high.
I don't know, man. Joseph might be giving that elevator the wide-eyed goggly look. Just don't think about it, don't think about it, don't think about it.
Taking a fear of heights in New York, goddamn city. Anyway, let's head on up.
Yep, let's head on up.
Okay. Elevator moves quickly and swiftly. Elevator stops. Boom! Doors slide open. Go ahead and make a courage roll of difficulty 6 for me, Joseph. Are you sure you want to get out of the elevator?
Well, it was assumed that the whole the connery would be in front of him, that would be obvious. He'd be standing at the back of the elevator, and then the elevator doors would be closing, and then they'd be looking around.
Oh, not again. Can't take that milk anywhere over 10 feet high.
So are we going to try and coax him out or just leave him in there?
Byron will, I guess, get back in the elevator before it closes, and he will try manipulate and I don't know how it worked, but he'll try to manipulate him in manipulation empathy, I guess, to get him to come out of the elevator.
Don't know what that would possibly be resisted by. Let's see.
I don't think really anything you could do to talk me into it.
You know, it's like if you're definitely afraid of something, it would be like, it's not like a whole garlic situation where you're like nauseated by it. You know, it's a sheer terror.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think anything will happen, but I mean, he'll make the attempt. Yeah. I'm not even rolling because I think it's going to fail. So.
Right. You know, Joseph doesn't look like he's wholly convinced.
Yeah, Byron is not going to use his powers on him. He doesn't, I mean, it's not life-threatening. So he will have been holding the elevator door, and he's just going to say, nope, I guess he's riding back down. Stay safe, Joseph. And he's going to walk back out and join the other two.
As he's going down, he's going to call up David.
In the elevator.
Is there any reception? I mean, this is a steel-girdered building with an elevator shaft, isn't it?
No reception. Not in the elevator.
He'll go out to the car, and then once he gets there, he'll call.
Do I have reception?
It's not the best reception you've ever had. You have better reception in your haven, but you actually do have it, and there's a vibrate. It's from Joseph.
Cool, because, I mean, this is 1990s era cell phones. Yeah?
You've got speakerphone, right? At least I can talk.
Are you serious?
Well, do you expect me to be coming up there?
Well, I expect you to either do that or not really participate.
There's no reason for me not to be able to talk to someone over a cell phone. That's kind of what they were made for.
It just strikes me as a little bit like it would get us a bad reaction.
Isn't that in basically the entirety of our existence since forming a coterie?
So you think we should just go for it full force instead of trying to get someone to like us?
Do you think you're going to manage to get a warlock to like you?
I certainly don't think having a Malkavian on speakerphone will help with that.
And without us, Ching Grimace has Eugenio sneak up upon us.
That all said, it's, considering that it's between me and Byron that know most of the story, do you think it's, intelligent to leave him as the one person who can say what happened? The whole of it?
Listen, either get someone else to put you on speakerphone, or suck it up and come back up here. There aren't even any windows.
Byron will have noticed Jeannie come up, and he will nod and politely and say, thank you for seeing us, Regent.
The gentleman before you appears to have been embraced in his early 40s. A mortal life of toil has given him a hearty physique, broad-shouldered and muscled impressively. Currently, he's actually wearing casual clothes. He's the least dressed of all of you, t-shirt, jeans, and sneakers. He's also fairly tall, almost 6 feet in height, with short black hair and brown eyes, and he's currently sporting quite the mustache. He looks a little amused and curious right now as to, you know, why some kindred are not a Glandramir hanging out playing Nintendo right in front of the elevator. He hasn't said anything, though.
I'm sorry. One of our friends had a little episode. He doesn't like heights, and so he rode back down on the elevator and we've been talking with him. Apologies for keeping you waiting.
Is it necessary for him to be here? It's not any trouble to go downstairs.
I think he would actually really appreciate that.
Right. We shall go then. Do 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 do. The elevator arrives back on the ground floor.
These dang loading screens. I'm telling you, man.
Well, at least they're hiding them inside of, you know, elevators and stuff instead of, you know, giving you a loading bar.
Yeah, I just always think of Mass Effect whenever we're going up and down elevators. I don't know why.
And then the game will hang up and crash during the elevator loading screen.
Yeah.
Son of a bitch! Girlissa, you all make it outside, and the woman behind the desk politely waves, smiles at Jeannie, and might walk out to a stewing and steaming Joseph out there. He's so steaming, he's speechless.
There's a reason he's on Marcus's side with everyone else over away from him.
Marcus, save from them. I can't hear you over the sound of my own depression.
Angst.
But Gina, sort of looks over at this other gentleman, sort of waves him aside. Come in, come in, come in, come in, come in. It's much warmer in here. And you all end up being in the foyer of the Maupassant room, sort of standing, maybe even a bit awkwardly. So, what's this all about?
The sheriff stopped by our place last night to pick up an artifact and bring it to the Tremere. He said he was going to bring it to the High Regent. We were wondering if you had any questions you wanted clarified on it.
An artifact. Could you go into detail?
A black rock that occasionally bleeds.
About yay big.
Size of a fist.
And you gave this to the sheriff?
And he said he was going to bring it to you personally.
Not to me personally, I'd certainly not say, because I haven't seen him.
No. The High Regent.
Haven't seen her either.
Is there?
Just an
If
artifact, how did you stumble across this bleeding black rock?
a very lengthy story involving what was presumably a flesh-crafted ghoul.
We'd be happy to talk about it in higher detail if whoever ended up with the rock has any questions.
The eyes sort of widen a bit. There is a flash of what you could describe as a mixture of anger and disgust upon Eugenio's face at the idea of a flesh-crafted ghoul. A crafted ghoul had this item within it. Flesh-crafted ghoul. Sort of gets lost in thought. Eyes actually zone out a bit somewhere between David and Marcus.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that last.
He zoned out.
Okay, I was making sure my
Just
mother
like
was still with
you.
me.
Yeah, he zoned out. Like I said, his eyes are somewhere, like, looking at, like, an opposite wall, beyond the group.
All right.
So, do you want to check and see if the High Regent has any questions?
He,
Or is that not the sort of thing that happens here? I'm not really familiar with Tremere.
sort of actually, well, zoned down, he, a slow frown draws onto his face, and he says, "Wait right here." Actually, he walks away a bit, possibly to go back to his office for a few minutes. Doo 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 doo. 10 minutes later. He actually comes back and says, No, I'm right. We certainly would have heard and had a great deal of interest in this item, this artifact, as you call it, that you gave to the sheriff. We would be interested in speaking with you more in depth about it. He offers an affable smile. He generally seems congenial and friendly, especially dressed as casually as he is.
Yeah, there's a Ferengi rule of acquisition that says the bigger the smile, the sharper the knife, and I think that might apply here.
Or he could be friendly.
Genie, genial, probably doesn't mean anything.
Nah, I think it's an ironic nickname.
We can't trust him, he's a warlock.
Yeah, I can't trust any of you.
You
Because
can
you're
trust me,
vampires.
David. David, trust me.
I can trust your intentions.
Well, anyway, so Byron is going to stand about a half inch taller. He's going to be vindicated that it's he feels that he's been proven to be correct, that Kadir was lying. And he's going to ask Eugenio, it's like, all right, well, where would you like to do this then?
Sort of gives a knowing look at Joseph and says, "Perhaps in one of the offices down here on the ground floor, if you would please. I have many questions."
Absolutely.
Yeah, ends up walking. The four of you, should all four of you choose to come along for the ride in too, just moderately decorated office with a desk, and it has four, reasonably comfortable chairs with a reasonably comfortable chair for him to sit at behind the desk. And he has some, actually has a laptop sitting there, which, he boots on and, he pulls up a word processing an application and as soon as the four of you sit down, he goes, "So, Artifact, can you describe this to me in greater depth? As much detail as you can recall, please do not feel as if any description at all is a waste."
Absolutely, and feel free to ask questions for clarification. It was a rock about yay big. He'll hold up his fist. Black in color. It was warm. It throbbed slightly.
Byron's going to stop you just so I can say, not just black. It was like a void. It was the absence of color, even more than black.
Right. It occasionally bled, especially in the presence of kindred and torpor.
Or wounded, it seems.
Or wounded. Here, you got a much better look at it. Why don't you go ahead, Byron?
Well, you summed it up fairly well. After this ghoul, this flesh-crafted ghoul was killed, it evaporated and left only this rock behind. And it was just a little warm to the touch, but when you brought it near wounded vampires, it would start to bleed and warm up. Have we mentioned yet if it brought you guys back from torpor yet? If not, I'm
We
not
did
going to
not
mention
mention
it.
that.
Okay, then he's not going to say that. So I suspect, although it's only a guess, that it may have been the power source for this ghoul.
And it actually brought me back from torpor. He'll kind of glance over to Byron as he enunciates the word me.
Genie pauses at his typing, looks up, arches a brow. Interesting.
I'm not sure about the details, but when I woke up, I coughed it out of my throat. Could you, tell them how it got there, Byron?
Sure. Well, since we tried various things, bringing it close to you, moving it around, and I just decided that maybe since it was leaking blood, it might somehow resuscitate you in some way. It was like just a wild guess. So I laid it on your chest, and it rested there for several moments, and then it just disappeared. I guess it was just soaked into your skin, and then you were revived, and you spat it out.
Oh, and it killed a plant, didn't it, Joseph?
Yes, I stuck it under a potting plant to keep it a little bit safer for a day, and in that day it killed the plant from completely healthy to absolutely dead.
I see. Did this alleged item exhibit any other properties? He looks among the four of you.
That's all that comes to mind for me. What about you guys?
I can't think of anything else.
Nope, that's pretty much all I can think of.
Very well.
And yeah.
Go ahead.
I mean, Marcus was just, yeah, I was pretty much in the exact same boat as David over here.
I'd be happy to answer any clarification questions if you have any.
Describe this flesh-crafted ghoul, please.
Ah, yes. David's then going to try to remember basically every detail that he could from the dossier, both from his personal observations and from eyewitness reports.
Okay, that's certainly reasonable enough for David to remember. But does Aaron remember?
Yeah, but it'd be really long to say.
Well, he did tell you don't leave out any detail.
All right, it was flesh crafted into what looked like the mockery of a snowman. It had three fleshy bulbs, a bottom one, a middle one, and then a head. It had stubby little legs that it waddled around on. It had what looked like buttons running up the front. Its arms looked very much like branches, like gnarled twigs reaching out from the sides, along with similar spurs of branches running along down. It had a scarf around its neck, a jaunty little Santa hat on top of its head. It was missing a nose or a corncob pipe, but it did have a big fanged maw with an infernal fire glowing within, and hate-filled eyes. It was, it was not a funny thing to look at. It looked like something made by someone with a sick sense of humor. It was absolutely goddamn enormous. It killed, well, what, two dozen mortals in a nightclub. It demolished a church. We barely managed to take it out from what I was informed secondhand was a series of bullets and shotgun blasts to the head. It could punch the ground to reach up with branches to entangle people. It could fire glowing streaks of heat through the air at things with a huge bellowing roar. It appeared to be able to see through, obfuscate. It was terrifyingly strong, was able to shrug off bullets oftentimes. It was a monster. And I'm happy to answer any questions you have about it.
Is there anything you others would wish to add to the description provided?
I
It seemed to be accompanied by a fog or mist, if I'm not mistaken. It seems that most witnesses, that happened first, and he would look at Marcus. Well, Marcus wouldn't know, but he would look around for confirmation.
Right, and that that sort of bellowing, keening roar it had. Right.
Hmm?
Yeah, it had a bellowing, keening roar, yep.
Oh, and it seems to be able to ignore injuries almost like a kindred in a rage.
Silence. Genie looks up from the laptop screen, very quick typer that he has, got down, you know, you all cannot see the screen, but he has been studiously and steadily typing the entire time as you all have described various things to him. As you all have finished, presses the enter key a few times, and looks up at the four of you and says, "A flesh-crafted ghoul, the rough physique of a snowman who could shoot beams of light from its mouth and had horrific claws like branches, who could burrow into the ground with them and grasp onto people, who had this very loud roar, and who apparently presence was heralded by the sight of fog."
Yes. So, you might want to tell the man where we first encountered it, since it was you, David.
Actually,
that might make a difference.
Small point. Joseph, Marcus, do either of you still have injuries from that fight?
I still have just, like, I'm not, like, aggro damage. I still have some lethal.
Joseph hasn't had a chance to heal at all.
Would you mind showing him your injuries from the, from that heat beam?
I'm pretty sure most of his injuries are actually centered around his neck. No, that, never mind. That was the kiss, not being bitten.
Right, that was actually a very minor thing. It didn't even do any damage.
That point. Genie looks from Marcus to Joseph, sort of tilts his head expectantly.
Joseph will take off his shirt and show him what I presume are burns.
Genie actually stands up from the desk and sort of crouches, sort of hunches over a bit to get a better look. Sort of like, doesn't actually lay a finger on Joseph, sort of just like walks around a bit to studiously observe. Doesn't have a camera out to take pictures or anything by the looks of things. Nor, you know, doesn't have any other items he wishes to pull to help the examining process. There is a rather telling a saucer-shaped, a circle, a scorch mark that still exists from where the creature laid a pretty good shot on the shoulder. I see. Burned like... how? Fire? Sunlight?
I would say it was almost like sunlight. It, certainly hurt the same way.
Hmm.
That said, it's a little bit hard to classify something like that. It was literally a beam of light.
David's actually going to have a slight look of surprise on his face for a moment before suppressing it.
Jeannie nods and sits back down behind the desk to type some more things in the laptop. How long ago did you first encounter this flesh-crafted ghoul?
The first time we encountered it visibly, or the first time we encountered its effects?
Looks up. The latter, please. He smiles.
Well, David's going to look around to see the looks that anyone might be giving him.
Byron is just stone-faced.
Mark isn't going to say anything.
Well, approximately... Oh, what was it? Does anyone remember the exact date?
Of what?
When we encountered the Steinway warehouse.
January 4th, 1998.
There you go.
On January 4th, we went to a warehouse in Steinway where we observed scorch marks much like those and a fog that approached as we were leaving. Later on, I am under the impression that a few weeks, a month later, their car was struck by a similar bolt of light while outside of the Muncie Hudson Shipping and Extraditing Center up north in the Bronx. And I myself observed it in person, physically, for the first time just 2 nights ago? Three?
I think it was three.
Yes, three, and 2 nights ago was when we killed the beast. It seemed to, at least in some way, have staked out the Muncie Hudson building as its own territory, because every time that anyone went up there, it made some manner of appearance.
He stops typing. Muncie Hudson Expediting and Storage Building in the Bronx?
Yes.
And this Steinway Warehouse District, Queens?
Yes.
I see. For what purpose were you up at the abandoned complex up there, if I may ask? Hunting for Sabat? You start typing.
That is a... Yeah.
I see. And this creature presumably had made an appearance. Do any of you know why this creature made an appearance at this warehouse district?
That is of a more delicate matter.
And speculation regardless.
I see.
Yes, we know nothing for certain about that.
Yeah, he pauses and chuckles and says, I'd be willing to hear rumors.
Byron will shrug and say, well, who wants to start?
Joseph's going to lean over the table and literally glare at Byron. Rumors, spreading rumors is probably not for the best.
All I'm willing to say for sure is that the reason we were in Steinway is on a tip from the Archon about potential Sabbat in the area. All of our initial encounters with it were while hunting Sabbat.
I see. Yeah.
Byron will nod. as if that's what he was going to say.
He begins typing some more. Yes, a flesh-crafted ghoul of that caliber certainly makes sense. The Zemitzi will naturally be involved, but such a creature would be a natural violation of... They wouldn't want to give us away into the kine either. Not unless they...
It did, buddy. Massacre 2 dozen people at a nightclub in Queens.
That said, it did manage to stay off camera while doing it, even if it left a number of eyewitnesses.
Right. It managed to somehow leave that building without going through any of the exits.
And I imagine it must have entered as well. Yes, I had heard of that event, but I had not known it was tied to this.
It was.
In fact, it was an attack on our friend here, and he'll Baron will glance at Marcus.
Yes, and the sheriff came by last night at our call to pick up the artifact. He said it was something that he should show to your High Regent.
Yeah, he actually has latched onto something else here for a bit. His head rotates to look at Marcus. Specifically for you at a nightclub, what do you remember of it?
Well, the exact incident I don't remember much of.
The
or anything.
The eyebrows widen.
He was extremely drunk that night.
But it is proven that he was there. If he was
it's
so drunk that he can't remember.
It's all circumstantial evidence, but almost certain.
There were eyewitness reports, but nothing more specific than that.
Well, a few fingers go up to actually twirl at a side of his mustache a bit. Why would the creature have been interested in you, or rather the four of you, simply being territorial?
Again, that would just be speculation on our part. All I know is that it didn't come attacking our territory until the night that I saw it in person at the Muncie Hudson building. And after that night, it attacked us every night until we killed it.
How many times have you been up there, the four of you, to that building?
Was that the third time?
Yeah, I think it was the third time.
But you all have actually been up there a varying amount of times.
Right, I mean, collectively, I think that was the third time. It was my first time. But collectively, I think it was our third time up there. Correct me if I'm wrong, I've only gotten secondhand information about the other occasions.
Yeah, the three of us went up twice, and then our Nosferatu friend went once on his own.
I see, I see. And this Steinway Warehouse District, just once?
Just the once.
Stops typing. I wonder how it was able to escape detection that entire time.
So do I, actually.
Certainly there are kindred who have been known to exhibit the potential for dematerializing within the Earth and reappearing in a different position. That's more of a Gangrel thing, but other kindred have been known to exhibit that as well. If these claws, as you mentioned, these branches could do that, maybe it could on a greater scale.
I certainly wouldn't discount it.
It would make everything make more sense.
Jeannie actually looks back at Marcus again. So you don't remember anything of the incident, Only that you were apparently extremely drunk, and circumstantial evidence would indicate that you were there during the time of the attack.
Yep, pretty much.
Type some more things down. I see. So, this creature, where by chance did you kill it?
In a church, actually. Owned by one of us.
I see.
It was attacking our territory. We managed to survive.
How by chance did you slay this snowman?
Bullets and knives.
Bangs as well.
They took the head off.
Firing a smirk. An expert shot to the head.
They
managed to hammer away at the head until it finally fell off. It took a lot of punishment.
I see. Extraordinarily tough. And it managed to handle the four of you simultaneously. Well, not exactly handle.
Well, there was only one of us standing by the end.
I see. And upon its demise, it vanished, leaving only this void black rock.
Melted,
not
by the sound
vanished.
Of
it. Yeah, it more evaporated off and left that in its place, as if that was the only part of it that couldn't evaporate.
Genie
I guess it's
pauses.
Sublimating.
Looks up at David and Marcus. How do you two feel right now?
I'm feeling fine. I haven't observed any possible real side effects since then. Have you, Marcus?
Well, aside from my... Well, I'm not going to say that. I felt mostly fine. Although yesterday I seemingly woke up missing an extra point of blood than I thought. I'm not. He's gonna say yesterday. I think I ended up losing more vitae than I normally would. I don't know. Any possible reasons could cover for that though.
Yes.
I was
yes.
Kind of indisposed.
A fight can take quite a taxing toll on one of us. Type some more. So it was just this yesterday when you spoke with the sheriff. You have a regular rapport with him, and I suppose since you had a tip from the Archon as well about handling these affairs. I am curious to know as to why the four of you did not wish to try coming here, maybe asking one of us about the affair, if it actually is an artifact.
Well, at the time we had already been in contact with the sheriff for a while, I went up to the Muncie Hudson building after a suggestion from him. It seemed the polite, appropriate thing to do to contact him first.
I see, I see.
Plus, he said that he was going to bring it here.
No, I do not think the High Regent would have lied about this. I certainly would have heard this sooner had actually anything come of note. Without, of course, any form of corroboration, particularly this item itself, and I don't suppose this creature left behind any other evident signs of existence?
Nothing but destruction and streaks of blood.
It is difficult to say. We, of course, will look into the matter to see whether such an item does exist, but with the creature having already been slain and melting, and this item not with us, sort of, it looks at the four of you and sort of smiles. You say the sheriff himself, Kadir, he took this with the intention expressed of giving it to us, and he has not.
Byron will say, yes, and at the time I thought he was lying. I tried to stop him from leaving, but there's not much that foreign inmates can do to the sheriff.
He actually did have an outburst to that effect. At the time, I thought he was overreacting. I'm sorry, Byron.
It's all right.
Now kiss and make up.
Now kiss.
I
bathroom,
see.
Now.
That is truly an interesting thing. Yeah, stops typing and actually leans back from the laptop, cracking his knuckles. Do you four have any reason to suspect anything of why Kadir would not give us this alleged artifact?
Well, we don't... You know better your relationship with Kadir than we do. So I think maybe you would know the answer better than us. I just know that he was lying.
Now is probably a good time.
Now is probably the worst time to tell them that... to tell the Tremere that you were involved with the Semitsi. Oh, that this is the worst time.
Oh, yeah, Byron is not mentioning it. That was him deflecting it, hopefully.
Right.
Genie looks curiously at Byron after he finishes speaking, and then at the other three. Well, you are the ones who apparently have regular discourse with him, and perhaps even the Archon as well. Saying to me that the sheriff apparently absconded with this alleged artifact is a powerful accusation. I would only ask if you had any reason or cause to suggest that, to explain why he would do such a thing.
Oh, for all
you
I know,
realize.
For all I know, he's put it in quarantine. It's only... anything that we say now would only be speculation.
But I'm asking you for speculation.
You realize that...
To be fair, we're just four neonates. I would really rather not speculate in a way that could earn us an enemy of someone who is ostensibly our friend.
Byron will snort. Yeah, maybe he's turned it to you three, but I think he might want me dead at this point.
Yeah, that's fair.
Genie looks to the left. Genie looks to the right and says, he's not here.
You do realize how powerful an accusation this would be, and without absolute, irrefutable proof, how unwilling we would be to say any such things against the sheriff. Currently.
If we pass a rumor and he suspects that we did, and really, we're the only ones that could have, considering the topic, it could be a death sentence for us, you understand?
He looks disbelieving at you. You've already been spreading so-called, presumably, rumors, with little in the way of corroboration, with no alleged artifact, no ability to signify the fact that there was a giant snowman pursuing you all, that you all fought it, and that the sheriff apparently took this item to do whatever with it. If I so wished, I could spread out this information amongst the harpies, and if he heard about it, particularly if such an encounter did occur at this church of one of yours. Her shrugs. Really, you have nothing to gain by lying to me. But he finishes a few more keystrokes. But if that is all that you wish to have share with us, we will keep this in mind.
Absolutely. Is there anything else you'd like to know about? I'm happy to answer any question that wouldn't possibly be me spreading slander.
Joseph's going to stand up, make it clear that he's going to walk. He wants to walk out.
I see. Unfortunate.
Yes, that's everything.
Would you like our numbers, any contact information in case you want a follow-up?
That won't be necessary.
Then it was nice talking to you. And Dave will extend his hand.
Eugenio looks at the hand, looks back at Dave and says, "You four can show yourselves out. Stay safe out
there." Dick!
Well, when someone knows that you're lying, when someone knows that you're withholding information that might be helpful to them and then continue to withhold information?
You know. I guess.
Yep. Well, Byron will stand and nod and say, "Thank you for your time. Thank you for confirming that you have not gotten the artifact here, as we suspected might have happened." And then with that, he will go.
The four of you leave without incident.
All right, well, once we're out of the parking lot, David will ask. So...
we should have told.
Do you guys have anything else you want to do as a group tonight?
I have nothing to do on alone.
No.
All right, I've got things I do as well.
Byron's got nothing to just say. I got stuff to attend to back in Astoria, I guess.
So then we all, I guess.
All right. David goes off to do his own thing. Byron's going back to Astoria, leaving Joseph and Marcos in front of the Mall Passant room. And Joseph's car.
Can leave without me, Joseph.
If you want me to drop you off, sir.
I'm actually going to be turning the corner, obfuscating, and then trying to follow Marcos.
Joseph's going to get into his car and drive back. He wants to feed.
Marcos is going to go backside.
Yeah, as soon as Joseph drives away and Marcus starts walking towards the door, David's going to walk back out and go up to him as well.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a perception plus awareness roll, Marcus, at difficulty 6.
Oh, he's going to unobfuscate as well. He's planning on walking in there with him.
Okay. Because that was a failure anyway. In which case, And David ends up just sort of, you know, loitering around, obfuscating, and then appears. Ah! Little fanfare.
Hello, David.
So how much are we to tell them?
I want to, if I want to see if you can fix my memory as well.
That's a good call. And I mean, he might be able to confirm what might have happened with you three down there as well. I'm not going to lie, the Tremere was going to be one of my possible resources on this matter.
Here's the thing, if he goes and tries to fix my memory, he'll see everything anyways.
So we tell him everything then?
Basically. What's the worst that can happen?
We die, or we're forced to flee into the night.
We've done worse.
We have.
So we're just going to tell him everything.
Alright, but you know more than I do. I'll back you up as best I can, but this is mostly on you.
Okay. So he's going to go in there, and if Mr. Estevez is still out there, he's going to say, I have something to talk to you about.
So he's probably back in the office still, though there's the lady who's still sitting behind the desk. Oh, did the two of you forget something?
Yes, there's something more we need to talk to him about. Can we head on up?
Oh, certainly. He should still be in the ground office. I have not heard him go back up yet.
Ah, perfect. Thank you very much.
And sure enough, as you two go back to where you left, Eugenio is still sitting back there, working on the laptop. He hears the two of you approach, looks up from the laptop, looks curiously at just you two.
So, you wanted some speculation on the sheriff's motives, right?
Couldn't do that with the others? Sort of lifts a brow.
No.
I see.
This is possibly self-incriminating. And we might have started a fist fight right here in the office.
But would you not be incriminating your other coterie mates as well through this? If this is, as you say, self-incriminating.
He'll look to Marcus.
Still for the best that we tell you either way.
Very well, then. Please, have a seat.
Note that spreading this information around could be dangerous for you as well. The Archon asked us not to.
The Archon, you mere neonates, as you described yourselves, do live very eventful lives.
We live in very eventful times.
That we do indeed. So, you are the two who came to me first, and now second. What do you wish to share?
Well, most of the information on my part is secondhand, except for the very beginning and the very end. Would you like me to start, Marcus, with the part that I was there for?
Sure, Court.
Well, in the Steinway warehouse, there was a survivor.
A survivor of this snowman.
Yes, we believe so. We were sent there by the Archon in order to hunt Sabbat, but what we found there was a group that apparently consisted largely of thin bloods. At the time, we thought that it was the work of the Scourge, but recent events have shown it might be otherwise, as, again, there were evidence of this snowman there.
And this one survivor, Sabbat? Not Sabbat?
Independent by the look. Well, it seemed to be independent. A girl by the name of Leslie Cutter.
He doesn't show any recognition.
Well, after discovering the girl, bringing her to safety, and one of our number apparently shepherding her out of Camarilla territory. And this is where it becomes speculation. We came under attack by the Sabbat, looking to track her down. Marcus, this is all secondhand at this point.
We took Miss Cutter. One of us was able to get Miss Cutter out of Manhattan and to Staten Island, where apparently we thought that she would be safe among the anarchs, far away from the Scourge, whatever was chasing her. Anyway, the Sabbat attacked us, I believe, one more time, or twice after this.
I don't know, I wasn't for it.
The Sabbat then bombed our build after they... The Sabbat, we hired a ghoul by the name of Jermaine Wallace. You may have heard of him. Anyways, we hired him because of an incident with David that ended up with David ending up in torpor. And we needed someone.
This is why all of the information I received on this time was secondhand.
David was currently indisposed for a very long time, and we hired a ghoul to help us against the Sabbat. As luck would have it, one of the nights after we hired Jermaine, we were attacked by the Sabbat. And soon afterwards, our place of the former O'Malley Estate building was bombed. You may have heard of this on the news. We believe the Sabbat were attacking us to get at Leslie Cutter because we were the last people who were seen with her. Anyway, we told the sheriff about everything that was happening. He told us to get Miss Cutter back from the Anarchs. And so we go to Staten Island, getting in a little boat during that storm back, I believe, in late January or early February. Either way, we go to Staten Island, and we found out that Leslie Cutter had left Staten Island sometime before that, and that they did not know where she was, except that she was looking for David. A few nights after this, we were approached by a ghoul by the name of Dmitri Patrishu, who invited us to meet his master. Now, what I'm about to tell you might sound crazy and might sound totally unbelievable, but everything that is following happened. Mr. Dmitri...
David will be watching this Tremere's face for the mention when Dmitri Patrishu is mentioned.
Okay. Doesn't look like there's a whole lot of recognition here. The ghoul... he is still listening with keen interest. He hasn't typed anything over the course of this story.
I actually appreciate that.
This ghoul, Dmitri, just to meet his master. His master's place of residence was underneath Central Park, through a little shack and an elevator that went miles down beneath the city.
There is an uncontrollable, like a reflex thing, where his hand slams into the desk and actually ends up leaving sort of a dent in it.
And his master's place was this giant mansion in...
Sevalot, Sir Vinny. Genie sort of hangs his head there.
Yes. Mr. Vasevalod offered us a reward return of Miss Cutter.
And from the story, Miss Cutter returned there with the help of their mercenary.
Yes, Jermaine was who, at the time when we were being offered the reward, most of us weren't thinking about doing it. I can almost honestly tell you. He was the one who spoke and said, could you... sire him.
Why did you go there in the first place? You were invited to by this ghoul Dimitri, but why?
I don't think they realized what they were getting into at the time.
We did not know that his master would be Cephalod. And also at the time, we were also at our wit's end about finding Scudder. We had no leads. We were just basically pulling our hair. And the sheriff was on our ass at the time. So we went...
Regardless, it was a poor decision on their part.
It was a poor decision on our part to hire and trust Jermaine Wallace. It was a poor decision on our part to go down there. And the story only gets worse from there. That night, after we got back from Mr. Cerveni's place, he had given an artifact, an item, that to Mr. Wallace that they said would help us find Miss Cutter. Lo and behold, we found her at Joseph's church.
Didn't you say that she was concealing herself with some sort of unusual discipline?
I believe name was Viserotica. I don't know if Marcus would know the name, but I believe he would say it's some discipline that's not like obfuscate.
Something that gargoyles have?
Perhaps. I'm not 100% certain about this.
I'm just saying what you guys repeated to me.
Yeah. The genie, very interested. Viserotica.
A couple of hours later, because we decided, for some reason, to attempt to talk with Miss Cutter and see if we could persuade her to come with us to the Camarilla. We waited a few hours, and the Sabbat attacked. It turns out that Miss Cutter was not, in fact, a thin blood, because she alone promptly destroyed one of them in hand-to-hand combat. Protean claws, you know. There was three of them. We killed two of them, and the third escaped in a car. Well, the third escaped on foot.
I'm not sure those particular details are important. We're trying to explain the situation with the sheriff.
And then, over the course of this, I became indisposed due to being extremely hungry and not wanting to endanger anyone of the group. I went off hunting, thinking that Byron and Joseph will handle this. And this is secondhand knowledge on my part as well. Somehow Jermaine got alone with Miss Cutter, and then he ended up driving her to Cephalod.
Is it at all possible that he overpowered her? Was it a kidnapping, you think?
Seeing the power that she showcased, I don't think it's possible that a ghoul could overpower her. All she would need to do would grow those claws again, and he would be torn apart like ribbons.
So, she was delivered to Cephalod Cerveni, yes?
Yes. And then we later learned that we told the
and
sheriff...
Right.
And then we told sheriff that we had what we had done, and he basically did not believe us.
From what I heard, he gave you an ultimatum, said that you still needed to deliver her or he would kill you. Right?
Yes. And so we basically had to scramble and find a way of getting Miss Cutter back from the Cephalod. We decided to go down there to ask him if there was anything we could do to trade for her back.
And it turned out that he was... following you invisibly, I think? That's what you
the sheriff
said,
was,
right?
The sheriff was following us invisibly that over the course of that night. I knew he, of course, was following us, but I did not want to break his disguise. And once we got down there, Mr. Cerveni found him and captured him.
I've heard something that Some said that he was missing for a week.
He was missing for an entire week, yes. And then he made a triumphant return and started trumpeting the whole Fight the Sabbat movement.
And he has no apparent memory of what happened there. Everything that's happened since I was there for, we got into contact with the Archon, who is a close personal friend of the sheriff, explained the situation. The issue that we've come to is that we don't know whether it's the sheriff who has been, had his memory altered by this, or if it's these three that were altered into believing that this happened to the sheriff. This is one of the main reasons why we don't want to go spreading around rumors, and one of the main reasons why the Archon has sworn us to secrecy.
Genie frowns. If memory editing were involved by Sevelod, I don't actually think there's anyone in the city who could fix that.
And we don't know if it's this coterie, the sheriff, both, neither. We don't know what level of trickery has been involved. And we've been sworn to secrecy on the matter, and I expect the Archon would react quite badly to anyone spreading such information around. You understand?
This incident with the flesh-crafted ghoul here, the snowman, Genie looks at Marcus. Do you have any cause or reason to believe that it pertains to Sevelod?
I believe it does not have anything pertaining to Sevelod.
It certainly predates their involvement with him.
It seemingly always, there was always an Ouroboros symbol that always seemed to showcase its arrival or was around.
Yes, I have noticed these Ouroboros symbols as well. There have been a few strange incidents within the city over the past year. Curious patches of fog, strange outcroppings of growth, curious faces, signs, a cellar being colder than it should have been. The Dragon Metro Cab Company, of course, being the curious one, but it has no ties that we could find to Zemitse. We did not have any reason to believe that these fogs would have been caused by a snowman.
And when we mentioned,
it could have been the other way around, that whatever was causing the fogs was manipulating the snowman.
But we have no reason to believe that this snowman was associated with the Sevelod. Because when we mentioned the Ouroboros symbol, he grew rather irate at his ghoul.
Irate how?
I actually don't remember out of character how he was irate about it, but I seem to remember him.
He was actually really angry about the corrupt file on the computer. He was more curious.
He was more curious
about the Ouroboros.
Okay, yeah, he was very curious about the Ouroboros symbols and wondering what it all meant.
And it doesn't seem like he had nothing to do with it as well yet. There can certainly be no other flesh crafter who is capable of creating such a snowman. Certainly none of these Sabbat junkies who come streaming in as spies from Jersey could be even remotely competent in 100 years to do such a thing.
Well, here's the thing. Earlier, apparently, the coterie witnessed Archbishop Polonia within the city. And, unless I'm mistaken, Lombok Ruthen was never accounted for after the Battle of New York.
No, he is a known coward. As soon as he was able to escape, he clearly fled. Although he may be close to Kane, he has no desire or taste for combat at all. From my understanding, he was actually here visiting an art exhibit whenever we struck. It was unfortunate that he was here, but we managed. And yes, I did hear that Polonia was in the city earlier, and a trap from the sheriff nearly caught him.
Yeah, that was our bad.
The nearly part.
So why do you suppose that the... You know, he's actually primarily talking to Marcus here, since he was the one who witnessed these things firsthand. Why do you suppose the sheriff would still be out hunting the Sabbat, out engaging in all these other activities when he ended up... What's a trail off?
I guess he wants to keep the Camarilla here squarely focused on the enemy they know, not the enemy they don't.
This is pure speculation at this point. Again, we're not sure that the coterie isn't the one that's been compromised. But apparently the sheriff didn't bring you the artifact, or he might be bringing you the artifact tonight, tomorrow night. Who knows?
Yes, he might have become busy, but we will try something right now with your permission, Marcus, if I may, to learn more. Your coterie mate, David, of course, will be here to watch should anything go awry. We will see just to what extent your memories have been altered, and it really is the best possible way at getting through to the truth.
You have my option.
Okay, so Gina gets closer, and it is very quick, actually, that Marcus is put into a hypnotic state in front of David's eyes, and Jeannie basically begins with a series of warm-up questions designed to draw out as much information, and it's all stuff that David can clearly hear. Nothing overly personal about, you know, where's your haven, where do you live, you know, did I fuck your mom last night, nothing like that, and it's going off based of what the coterie has already said, and digging deeper into the situation. He's actually rolled well enough. The block that was on Marcus's memory in regards to him not being able to remember the incident that happened at the club has been completely removed. He remembers every single iota and nuance of him being there, and the creature appearing, and he remembers falling unconscious. The problem is that apparently he wasn't conscious for anything that happened afterwards, and he did legitimately wake up in his bed in a new set of clothes, and apparently healed.
That doesn't answer all my questions, but it does tell me one.
No. But that block there is removed, and Marcus confirms it aloud, being compelled to tell the truth in front of David. And he was there, and the creature did knock him unconscious. Jeannie does eventually pull Marcus out of this hypnotic trance. Says, interesting.
Well, now he should know what the thing looks like, because I think I got a decent look at him.
Yeah, there was a very nuanced and detailed description of the creature involved. And other questions involve the whole concept of the meeting with the sheriff, and of course, meeting with Sevelot, providing details about that. There was a lot, you know, quite a bit of time passed. David could certainly tell it about 40-ish minutes passed during the process. Genie was
David's
that.
Actually going to be making a point of keeping a very detailed memory of all of this, because this is probably going to be a lot more detail than he's been given of the events that passed.
Oh, yeah. Certainly, and Genie just basically went through the whole smorgasbord of everything that happened from, you know, this first incident here to covering the latest incident, basically focusing around the artifact as well as the sheriff and this flesh-crafted ghoul. And naturally, Sevelot is a very interesting topic to Genie as well. Whenever Genie does pull out, he does say, interesting, and sits down behind the desk again. He doesn't type, he sort of sighs and says, that took care of some of the blocks, so something was involved. I can't say who, though, and you losing consciousness doesn't exactly help the situation either. Apparently, though, you were fixed up. Nearly final death, as you were. Whoever did this to you had the capability and the means and the desire to release you.
Do you know of anyone who has the ability to heal vampires?
Yeah, Genie says, certainly it is possible, it is not unheard of. Or that perhaps in your unconscious state you were fed blood, and while incapacitated, your undead body did what it thought was most natural, and you just simply don't recall.
I've never heard of a person dealing damage from burns and sunlight that quickly, though.
Neither have I. There is a strong frown on his face. Perhaps rescued somehow? There is not enough information to even offer speculation, only that for whatever reason you survived the encounter, and from what you have told me, that is a lucky thing.
I consider myself lucky, but I'm still wondering what happened during that missing night. Did you hear that, or am I going crazy?
I heard that.
But that
what
doesn't
was it
allow
I'm supposed
your,
to hear?
Yeah.
The fourth wall! Genie sort of scratches his mustache and says, and with the information that you gave, there's no way you could have been lying to me. Unless your memories were changed by someone greater than I, which is not impossible, particularly not as Sevelot is here, and active. Nevertheless, you did provide a very detailed description of that rock, and Sevelot has been here for hundreds of years, back before this settlement here even became recognized by the Sabbat. There's no telling exactly why he chose to move to the New World, perhaps to get away from the fangs of his lessers. Only that he has, and for the most part he has taken an ambivalent, nonchalant attitude towards everything, content to loiter and curl up there deep beneath his domain. It is in effect
we have actually noticed and documented, and many Zamitzi who actually become afraid of stepping out of their havens, even as powerful as they can get in Sevelod's case, of just pure, unadulterated fear as if they are overcome by Rotshrek.
Some sort of agoraphobia?
Genie nods. We're not sure why this occurs. Perhaps it pertains to their inability to properly rest without soil that matters to them. We're not sure. Only that it does occur. And we had figured that Sevelod was, although he had feelers out in the city, he was just some ancient relic, researching what have you, and for our part, we have been unwilling to make a guaranteed enemy out of him. For his part, he has been content to not interfere in the affairs of the Camarilla, and more specifically, Clan Tremere. And if he's not going to be an active threat up to this point, we have not wished to try to deal with them. But if what has been documented is true, that Sevelod may have influenced Kadir in some fashion, and this changes the entire scope of affairs, particularly with his rising popularity within the city of New York.
What are you going to do with the information?
This is not a decision that's up to me individually.
It's that zoned out look again, staring between the two of you at some distant point on the wall.
David is beginning to suspect that he's in telepathic communication with the Grand, or the High Regent, rather.
But this would give us cause to act against Sevelod, and with due haste. Whether he directly was involved with this or not, he has thwarted many plots over his unlife simply by being here, and by this instance, we may have to deal with him. The problem is that, living so far down there without outside interference for so many years, we simply don't know what he can do.
Well, Marcus gave you some account.
That is true, but obviously he would naturally feel comfortable in his own mansion, but there's no telling whether that is some, we suspect, an artificial cavern created down there for his own little wonderful house. Everything down there could be fiend-tainted. We could attempt to engulf the whole cavern in flames only for him to easily escape. There have certainly been stories over the years rumoring at what he and what powerful Zamitzi can do, but again we get into the situation where there's no one here who, even with the entire power of Clan Tremere, even with the entire power of the Camarilla, it is uncertain what the outcome would be.
So you're saying need someone just as powerful as the Cephalod here?
I'm saying that the best that could be done would likely be to chase him away, but whatever plan is in effect, we won't be able to excise the source, merely its immediate effect. We would have to excise the sheriff.
The Archon won't like that.
He breathes and sort of exhales and says, "No, he will not. But I would dare say that no one would really like if a Toreador under the domination of a Zumitsi obtained the princedom."
I don't think anyone like anyone. I don't think anyone would like a prince who was under the thumb of a Zumitsi as prince.
This is very valid and valuable information that you have brought to the attention of not just Clan Tremere, but the Camarilla as a whole, and it certainly is understandable why you would have tried to pursue the channels you have. I'm interested as to why you did think the best idea was to give, or at least show, this alleged artifact to the sheriff if you thought that Sevelod might have done something to him.
I actually had almost no involvement with the artifact other than it being used to bring me out of torpor.
And I'm still not convinced, or at least wasn't, until the sheriff took the artifact and hasn't given it to the Clan Tremere, that he was the one under the influence. Remember, I wasn't around for any of this.
Genie inhales deeply.
Then, sort of holds his head a bit and shakes it. Clenching his temples a bit, regardless of... Oh, this is gonna be a mess.
Yes, I... There's a good chance that when this comes to light, the Archon might come for us.
He will not, particularly if the weight of the entirety of Clan Tremere is behind this. Not even the Archon would be so bold. I can certainly verify the legitimacy of what I have just drawn from your friend's mind. And certainly the sheriff has given small indicators, particularly after his vanishing of a week, of suspicion. The problem is that we simply can't operate on that, but any sort of compromise at all, it cannot be allowed to occur. The primary headache actually comes through the Sabbat. Ever since Calibros abdicated, we have been in a position of sort of panic, of anarchy in the city, and this gridlock that we've all been in as we vie for the princedom, trying our best to unite the ivory tower into one whole, has only presented an even weaker front, particularly if Polonia himself was sighted within the limits of the city. Should this continue, there is no telling what the Anarchs might do, what the Gangrel might do, what the Sabbat themselves, merely on the other shore, might do. And if not just you, as you and your coterie mates, but other word seeps out that the sheriff's leanings are slanting, no, this has to be dealt with.
It's difficult to say exactly how he looks. You know, he might be regretful, he might also be pleased by it. After all, it is definitely known by the two of you that he is eyeing the princedom as well.
Right.
And after tonight, he may have just gained two more supporters.
Actually, I'm still behind Carter Vanderwaden, but I'm okay with this guy.
Yeah, I'm okay with this guy, but if...
He's a good compromise candidate, you know?
And I'm going to put this right now. If Marcus didn't know Kadir was supporting...
Oh, yeah, no, he
would still be supporting him.
Yeah. Anyway, David is now going to say, "Listen, if this comes to light, and it turns out that we were wrong, It was only the two of us that came to you, not the rest of our coterie. But if it turns out we were right, then they were backing us as well. Okay?
Genie nods and says, I understand.
I don't want anyone of the two of us to take the fall for this.
You won't be the only ones. I will be sticking out my neck as well. It is rare, but I believe in the truth of what you have spoken, and the sort of idea behind this, and the sheriff definitely has been furtive and secretive enough where this could. Sort of zones out a bit again and nods. This item, it's... Sevalod must have been viewing through the eyes of his dominatee and recognized this and thought it was of some significance. The problem is that we don't know what. You said that he was also curious about all of the signs of the Ouroboros and these various curious things as well. Was there anything else he expressed interest or concern or desire over here?
Didn't he express some interest in Lombok Ruthen?
He wanted to find his grandsire, Lombok Ruthen.
Huh.
At the time, it seemed to me he had came to the city looking for Lombok Ruthen.
But clearly isn't the case, since he's been here for centuries.
That creature itself that you defeated couldn't possibly have been him. He's been known as a coward. Why would he? Yeah, certainly it's within his possibilities to create such a thing.
Is he the sort that has the sick sense of humor to create a fleshy snowman with a jaunty Santa cap on?
It is fair to say that after several thousand years that just about anything could be his sense. He is, after all, one of them. Genie looks perplexed and confused himself. That's why he's going on to these tears of speculation.
Hasn't Marcus seen Lombok Ruthen before? Has anything seen the destruction he's done before?
Oh yeah, there was a very personal encounter there. Marcus was at that battle where Lombok Ruthen personally made an appearance. That was also the battle in which Marcus was heavily wounded.
Yeah, I mean, Marcus will mention, even though Lombok Ruthen is a known coward, he still ripped apart many vampires at the Battle for New York.
Oh, certainly.
I would know I was there.
I was involved in the battle myself, and regardless of how cowardly or foolish he might be, he is still a fourth generation. There is no doubt that he possesses powers far beyond any of ours, which only just draws more confusion rather than anything else.
It could be this was some Semitsi plot, unrelated to the two of them.
Semitsi plot, unrelated to two of the more powerful. Certainly wouldn't be impossible, but why there would be such great interest in here instead of anywhere is beyond me. This will be something that will be discussed and debated and perhaps acted upon. In the meantime, I would advise the two of you, and perhaps the other two as well, to hunker down.
That's a good idea. Now, I'll repeat the offer from before. Would you like my phone number or any other way to contact us?
In the interest of being congenial about it, yes, provide it to me.
All right, he'll jot it down for him. And would you like to give us any number to contact you if we have any more information? If not, I can always just come back here.
Yes, you may certainly come back here. And it should not be too much trouble, especially after what's been revealed. But there's no telling exactly what might come of this. First right.
If anything.
We'll see. I do believe, unless you two have anything else, that it would be for the best that you left. My night has suddenly become much busier.
I would just like to reiterate, if there are any negative consequences for the coterie, please specify that it was just the two of us. We don't want to take the other two down with us.
I will make sure that your coterie is sort of disguised from any brunt of thing. If anything does come, it will be from a united Tremere.
I very much appreciate that. And then David's going to hold out his hand to be shaken.
Genie actually clasped onto it this time.
Marcus will stand up and say, I thank you for fixing my memory, or what of it you can fix.
And Genie sort of shrugs, whether Sevelod altered the rest, can't say what he's done, only that suspicions abound with the sheriff seem to suggest that it is he who has been toyed with and that you all do distinctly recall.
It definitely does suggest that, as of this event. Well, thank you for seeing us.
He nods.
And we can see ourselves out again.